Well, you know, the feeling is just, it's a dream. Every time you're, every time you think of it now, you wish you could play the game and then take yourself out and watch yourself play because as an infant, you know, you always watch Stanley Cup Finals, especially being a Canadian boy. That's the greatest thing. You sit there with your pop and your chips and your father, and, you know, he's got his beer, and it's just great. You watch it, and here you are, you know, you're in it. That's why it's so much more exciting and more fun. You know, like, I like to be a 12-year-old playing every Stanley Cup game because when you're 12 years old, you just have fun, and that's what you should do in the Stanley Cup because this is what you've dreamed of, and there's no sense dreading it and going out and making a tough time of it for yourself. It's tough enough to play against the other team without playing yourself, so you have fun and you just enjoy the game.
I think hockey is a game, a child's game, played by men. And to play it effectively, you must have fun just like children do. I've been with too many teams in sports through the years where you weren't allowed to open your mouth, you weren't allowed to laugh, you weren't allowed to question the coach or anybody in authority. You lived in fear. My players don't live in fear. They get up in the morning, they're happy, and they go to bed, they're happy. And that's the kind of person I am. I believe in precision and discipline, and that's the way I was brought up. Everything has to be exact. Everybody has to be on time. Everybody has to conform, and everything has to be in its place. In other words, our system, we have to constantly work on it. We work on it 45 minutes every day. We work on it and work on it so that we leave no room for doubt. Everything has to follow a certain pattern.
Anchored by Bernie Perrault, the best goaltender in the league, Fred Giroux's system has already brought the Philadelphia Flyers their first championship, last year's Stanley Cup. Tonight it brings them to the edge of their second against the high-scoring Buffalo Sabres as the final round begins. Jersey Sabres tore through the regular season with an explosive offense that averaged almost 5 goals a game, dancing past opposing defenses with a shifting flow of fast young skaters who attacked in clusters, seeming forever able to keep their shots on net. But no team defended its goal game after game as well as the champion Flyers. Playing in front of the almost invincible Perron was a tight spiderweb of alert defensemen who guarded their end of the ice with disciplined quickness and the rather convincing physical argument that they were the only ones entitled to be there. Two teams of superb hockey players, men with men's skills who were once children with children's dreams, meeting on the last stretch of the icy road to the Stanley Cup. The Sabres open each of the first two games with characteristic power, firing shots at the Flyer goal in almost continuous waves of sweeping motion. But the constant attack met a constant resistance as Perron stopped everything, while the rest of the Flyers, playing Giroux's system of total team defense, methodically set up their own scoring opportunities. And the first goal of the series was Philadelphia's as Ed Van Impe shoots and number 7 Bill Barber slaps in the rebound. The Flyers won the first game 4-1. And again in game 2, Philadelphia's defensive poise completely neutralized Buffalo's thunder, while the Flyers' own scoring threats like Reggie Leach and the gracefully aggressive Rick McLeish stood ready, watching, waiting. The blueprint of the Flyers' success can be studied in detail by watching the play of their captain, number 16, Bobby Clark. When he is on the ice, he is everywhere on the ice. Defensively alert, offensively daring, infusing Philadelphia with a contagious enthusiasm and supplying endless energy to the swarming instinct that is the heart of Giroux's system.
He has a very good insight into the game, probably more so than any other hockey player I ever coached. He can sense the problems we're having maybe even quicker than I do, or he can sense a solution to it. where I may hesitate and want to wait until we get into the dress room before I decide what to do. And he'll say, now I know I'm right.
With a score tied 1-1, Clark's third period goal through the pads of Sabre goalie Jerry Desjardins gives Philadelphia its second straight win. Clark's control of his team's offense sends the Flyers off to Buffalo with a two-game lead.
Oh, I'm sure that, the difference between a lot of guys is, the old equalizer is hard work. Some guys have a lot of ability, but, they don't work as hard. And guys with lesser ability work harder, I think that's the equalizer. If everybody, worked as hard as they could, each player, then obviously the guys that had the most ability would shine all the time.
Hard work has always been the key to success, and the Flyers are a hard-working team, and you mentioned Bobby Clark a little earlier. He always puts out 150%, and he really works hard. I've got to give the guy credit. He goes out in every game. He just gives his best. Sometimes you can see he's just dead tired, but he's still pushing himself, and that makes you go, too. You see a guy like that and you say, well, I'm not going to be outdone. Man, you got to put out. You got to try. It's worth it. And I really want my name on that cup this year. And all we have to do is go out and work.
Playing their first game at home in this final round, the Sabres in white now had to win here to keep the series from becoming a rout. Philadelphia jumped off to a quick two-goal lead, and Buffalo could have become extinct right then and there. But Rick Martin, number 7, lived up to his words about hard work as he and Gilles Perreault and René Robert, his teammates on Buffalo's famous French Connection line, finally began to gel, and the entire Buffalo offense seemed to come alive. Danny Gare scored at 11:46, and only 17 seconds later, the quick-wristed Martin tied the score at 2-2. But Buffalo's joy was brief. Philadelphia regained the lead 2 minutes later, and as the second period begins, the Sabres find themselves once again in an uphill battle to catch up. It also begins with a new Buffalo goaltender, veteran Roger Crozier, the most valuable player in the 1966 playoffs, who replaces the shaky Desjardins and immediately boosts the Sabres' spirits with a string of dazzling saves. Again, the Sabres tie it up, and again, the Flyers pull ahead as the hometown fans in hot, humid Buffalo are wondering if the disappointing pattern of this series will ever be broken. But midway through the third period, Rick Martin fakes his way past defenseman Jim Watson. Perrant comes out to stop the shot, but Bill Height swoops in to put the rebound into the net, and suddenly, the game is tied again. But by now, something else has been added to the tension on the ice. Fog. The unusually warm, moist air inside the arena has deposited a blanket of heavy mist along the surface, and the action becomes a surrealistic, dreamlike ballet. The players floating through mysterious, opaque clouds, the puck gliding somewhere around their skates, appearing and reappearing with maddening unpredictability. At both ends of the rink, desperate defensemen struggle to relieve the extra pressure in front of their exhausted goalies. But incredibly, the 4-4 tie continues as fatigue and uncertainty weaken each offense, and Game 3 slides into sudden death overtime. Endless coaching and countless hours of practice have prepared them for anything that might happen on the ice. But the uncontrollable elements of nature combine to overheat their bodies and sap their energies. For the goalies especially, behind their confining masks, the game becomes an ordeal. Almost 18 and a half minutes of overtime have been played.
Lace winning the draw, turns at his own line, lost it along the boards. Robert tipped it back for Perreault, too far. Jim Watson over to Van Imp. Van Imp comes to center, flipped it ahead. It bounces over Height's stick. He has to hustle back after it. Height stops in the corner to shake off McLeish. Around it comes to Rick Martin. Up ahead for Perreault. Perreault coming to center. Dumps it off the boards in the corner. Robert going after it. He scores! René Robert! And the Sabres win it again in overtime!
mood was changing. What had two nights before been a group of badly demoralized Buffalo Sabres had become a band of excited young athletes who believed in themselves again. They had beaten the unbeatable Bernie Parent with 5 goals in the last game, and they came out smoking for game 4. Their confidence restored, their scoring ability renewed. This team had ripped games wide open all year long. They had blazed past the Montreal Canadiens to make it into this final round, and now their pulsing energy could be felt in every part of the arena. The zip was back in their skates. Sureness had returned to their strides. Once more, their passes began to click, and the Buffalo Sabres grabbed the momentum of this series. They were loose again. They were confident again. They were having fun again. There was a new crispness to the way they moved the puck as more and more of the game was being played in the Philadelphia zone. And no longer were the Flyer forwards being allowed to skate unmolested into Sabre territory. The tight checking that marks the Philadelphia Flyers was no longer their monopoly as the Sabres accepted the challenge for control of the puck and fought for its possession like a team convinced of its right to it. And the goals came. Shiro recognized all too well the hazards of facing an inspired hockey team, but signaled his goalie to leave the ice for the last minute of the game so he could replace him with more offense, another skater, and maybe tie up the game. The 3-2 Sabre lead was within reach, and as the fog eerily began to form again, the play became more precise, the tension accelerated, and the final jousting began. Philadelphia would have to force the puck into the Buffalo end, and with Perron off the ice, their net empty, they would have to keep it there, setting up their shots and taking them before Buffalo could adjust. But with only 28 seconds left, Don Luce streaks away with a stolen puck, feeds Danny Gare, and the series is tied, 2 games apiece. The challenger has caught up to the champion. The teams stand even. But part of hockey's magic is the explosive physical energy that releases when bodies clash on the slick surface of the ice. And as the series shifts to Philadelphia, the flashpoint nears. The equilibrium stretches until it finally snaps. jubilant Flyers take the fifth game with a convincing 5-1 win and need only one more victory to repeat as Stanley Cup champions, while the Sabres must fight all the tired cliches about never giving up and taking the series one game at a time. Buffalo coach Floyd Smith is reluctant to confuse his team now with massive changes, so he makes only one, a switch of goaltenders. And as the Buffalo fans file into Memorial Auditorium, the man they see warming up is Roger Crozier, an old hero in a new uniform reaching for yesterday's fire. When the desire to play goalie first strikes a young boy just learning the game, a subtle thing happens that forever separates him from the other kids and condemns him to bear an extra measure of pressure from that moment on. Perrant and Crozier are themselves united in a strange bond, dueling each other as well as each other's teams. And one of the most fascinating tangents of Stanley Cup play unfolds, a pair of goalies locked in scoreless battle as both teams probe for the most fruitful blend of cautious defense and bold attack. Through the first two periods, the Flyers and the Sabres flash up and down the ice, testing each other, challenging each other, searching for a single weakness to exploit. But neither team can find one. Goaltenders play brilliantly, turning away dozens of shots, but a growing awareness begins to spread through the arena that it can't last, that kind fates are being prepared for one of the players, a Saber, a Flyer, someone who can't possibly know yet that he is about to become a hero. Barely into the third period, the puck goes behind the Buffalo net. Legs churning, muscles straining, Flyer Bob Kelly chases it and bangs in the game's first goal. Just 11 seconds had gone by, and as the replay shows, Kelly simply pulled his way into position, found a tiny opening around Crozier, and the first goal of the night against the gallant veteran gives the Flyers a slim lead, but one few other teams could protect as well. While Kelly's joyous teammates gathered to congratulate him, a prophetic hush seemed to descend on the crowd as they sensed the edges of their dream begin to fade away. And it would, unless the Sabres could come down to the other end of the ice and shatter Perrant's perfection. Buffalo now rush 3 and 4 men at a time, sacrificing some defense for the goal they had to have. Only minutes remain as the puck is worked around the back of the Flyer net, out to Jerry Korab, who fires a shot at Perrant. It's blocked in front, comes loose. Suddenly, the Flyers are the ones on the attack. Kindrichuk slides the puck over to Bill Clement, and the young winger deftly applies the coup de grace. And from somewhere in the building, the silver-tiered Stanley Cup begins its journey to the ice. This was a victory fashioned by goals from two non-starters, proving how efficient the Shiro system was, relying on desire and hard work to complement a mastery of the game's fundamentals. And it was the way Philadelphia had coolly and efficiently eliminated so many of its opponents. All season long, the Flyers had heard tiny voices calling their championship a fluke, daring them to try it again. And now their second straight Stanley Cup was only 2 seconds away.
I think hockey is a game, a child's game played by men. And to play it, you must have fun just like children do. I've been with too many teams in sports through the years where you weren't allowed to open your mouth, you weren't allowed to laugh. But my players don't live in fear. They get up in the morning, they're happy, and they go to bed, they're happy.
The pressure released, their prize secure. These are the children who long ago put skates on and never took them off, who grew numb in winter's chill, practicing for hours on frozen country ponds, who dreamed of putting their hands on the silver Stanley Cup. And for the two goalies released now from battle, a shared pride in a fleeting moment of understood equality.